Toots and Dudettes. Good morning, guys, and welcome back to the channel. So, I guess an apology is in order because I haven't posted a video in 8 days, so I'm sorry, guys. Let me find a solution to this. It's gonna take a little bit of time, but I will find a solution eventually. But I wanna start today's video off with a conversation and debate and debacle that's been on my mind for the past few months, and that's this whole high school versus club drama that's going on right now, and that you can't play high school if you play DA, this whole debacle kind of thing. So I wanna kind of settle this debate in this video right now, because there's a lot of videos out there and articles that state this way or another, but don't really find or have an affirmative statement or a really just conclusive opinion regarding this subject. So I'm gonna settle this right now in this video and talk about kind of the pros and cons of each league or division, whatever the heck you wanna call it. But high school versus club, it's gonna be settled in this video right now. So roll the intro. So to begin this conversation, guys, I want to start out with just a stat, a figure, some analytics. I know no one cares about this kind of stuff on this channel, but it's important to have this kind of out there before we begin today's video. So in a survey that the NCAA commissions, I guess they created, but they surveyed over 21,000 student athletes inside the NCAA. This is in D1, and of those 21,000 student athletes, over 95% of them said that they played club. So that's kind of a big hammer to the chin for high school. But that's not the end to this debate right there. There's a lot more to it, backstory and stuff, and just more facts and figures to support high school. So there's a lot more to it than just that one figure, but it's important to have that out there right away because it's a big number. 95% of student athletes in college right now played club, but there's four other leagues besides NCAA. So there's more to it than just this one figure. But let's step back a little bit and talk about my playing history and kind of the way I went to college. I haven't talked too much about my playing history on this channel. I think I did a video maybe last summer that kind of talked about a little of my background, but I grew up playing at the YMCA, and that was by far the best way to really grow at a young age. That was the best way to do it, in Florida at least. In my region, I was on the west coast of Florida, and most players my age played at the YMCA. So from the age of like 4 to like 8 or 9, I grew up playing at the YMCA. Now for those of you who know the level at the Y, it's not that great. I guess that's the honest answer for that, and I'm sure even now it's worse than it was in the 90s. But back when I was 4 to 8 years old, that's where I grew my confidence to play, was at the Y. I can't even imagine, guys, or think about or just configure my mind or just think about in general what my confidence would be like if I was told that playing at the Y was making me an inferior player, that it wasn't real competition. And players are told that now, but I can't even imagine what it would do to my confidence if I was told that at a young age. It would just destroy me. And I was fortunate that I wasn't told that, but I know it happens to this day. And I can't comprehend why players are told this at the high school level, that high school is just for fun, it's just for playing with friends, it's not real competition. The last time I checked, guys, was pretty recently actually, but the last time I checked, even pro players, the highest league caliber level, are still having fun and still playing with their friends. So you can shove that down your haters' throats whenever you want to, but please do it in the next few days because that would greatly benefit my video, and you guys can tell me what they said down in the comment section below. But moving on here, guys, I got a whole list of things I want to talk about and debate with you guys in this video. And the first thing is just understanding the pros of high school. No one really fully explains all the pros of high school and why you should be playing high school. So let's dive into all the pros right now and why you should be playing high school in 2019. Draw the top when it's cold, but you feel the heat. So the first pro of high school, I'm going to list just a few things pretty fast here so I don't rant for too long. But the first pro of high school is that it's free. So most of the time you just need to do some fundraising or something for the team itself, sell some shirts and sweatshirts, and that's your funding for the team itself. So most of it comes from the school, the traveling expenses and all the buses and stuff, and the food are paid for by the school. So most of the time it's free for players to actually participate in the team. So that's the main pro right there, is that you need no money really at all to play for your high school team. The second main pro of high school, guys, is just the experience factor. And by experience, I mean playing with players that are more mature. And by mature, I mean playing with older players. And that's not really talked about at all in American soccer. In American high school, is that club doesn't offer that, and high school does. And when I was in college, that's the first time I experienced playing against players that are 4 years older than me. And when you're a freshman in high school, when you're 13, 14 years old, playing against players that are 18, 19 years old is monumentally, is incredibly beneficial to your career down the road. So high school offers that and club doesn't. The last pro of high school that I can really relate to and talk more in depth about is just the sense of community, the sense of continuity, the sense of just family. In the 1 year I played high school soccer, that's really the first time that my family was really into it. Not saying that they weren't in the past, but to have my name in the paper and stuff, have my name in the local newspaper was neat. And I enjoyed that, my family enjoyed that. But just having the sense of community and fighting for your school is cool. And I don't know if that's the best word for it. Cool is a pretty bland word, but it was neat. It was enjoyable to be in the newspaper, have your name recognized throughout your family. So from a price aspect, from a community aspect, and just family aspect, and then experience aspect, and the final thing to kind of touch on is just discipline. So if you don't have good grades, good behavior, you can't play on the team. So playing high school soccer kind of keeps you in line, keeps you focused and on the right path, if that makes sense. So those kind of four or five main things are why you should play high school soccer in 2019. All right, so moving on to the cons of high school soccer. I think to start with, I need to put a little disclaimer out there and just say that this is just opinion. It's not facts. I have a large amount of experience in this area, but again, it's just opinion. It's not facts. I'm not trying to offend anybody. This is just my honest answer and opinion and just assessment to the pros and cons of high school soccer. So take everything I say with a grain of salt. It's just opinion, it's not fact. But having said that, the first con that needs to be touched on, talked about, is just the aspect of training. Training really is not that great. From a quality aspect, it's not great. From a coaching aspect, it's not great. And then from a frequency aspect, it's not great either. So training is maybe 2-3 times a week, which is not, in my opinion, enough to grow and develop to your fullest potential. You need 4 or 5 trainings a week, practices a week with the team, to really reach your true potential. And all the teams in my area didn't have that growing up. I'm sure times have changed now in regards to training. It's probably a little bit better, but even the quality of the training is lagging right now. And bringing up the training itself kind of goes hand in hand with the coaching aspect. So the quality of the coaching really is not where it should be either. So most high school coaches are also teachers in the classroom as well. So their main job and source of income is teaching, and their side gig, their second job, is coaching. So their knowledge and expertise and really the purpose and true, I guess, skill set is focused in the classroom and not on the field. So that's kind of where the problem arises in regards to the training aspect and the quality aspect, is that the coaching is not by someone who actually has profound knowledge in this sport. Their profound knowledge is in the classroom and not in the field. So from a coaching aspect and just perspective, it's just not good enough. From the quality of session perspective, it's just not good enough. How many times you train perspective and the frequency, it's just not good enough. There's a lot of things that need to be worked on when it comes to high school, but the most important thing that can really be talked about and discussed is just the exposure aspect. So that's kind of the fourth main point, is just being exposed and getting kind of the looks and recognition that you deserve. And players in high school aren't given that opportunity to have those looks and recognition because scouts aren't watching those games. The main problem with high school soccer is not the coaching, it's not the quality of the training, it's not how often you play, it's not the frequency, it's just how often college scouts attend the game. It's exposure. Exposure is by far the most important thing to really develop you and to progress your careers. Being exposed to the right people at the right time. It's who's watching you and who you playing. That's by far like the two most important kind of phrases there are in college sports, is who's watching, who you playing. If you're not playing somebody good, there's a good chance that no one's watching. If no one's watching you, there's a good chance that you're not playing a good team. Those are kind of like the two main sentences and phrases that go together to really recruit you and further your career down the road. It's not a fully effective system, guys. It's not fair. It doesn't seem right. I think we all know that. But having said that, I think we are finding diamonds in the rough. I think we are finding hidden talent out there in smaller cities and smaller schools. But when we find those diamonds in the rough, how do we nurture those players and develop those players into players that can play professionally? That's the real question we need to ask ourselves when it comes to finding diamonds in the rough. We can find them all we want, but how do we nurture them and develop them into pro caliber players? There's a lot of issues that expand a lot further than just recruitment when it comes to American football, but that's a topic for a different day, because we can talk about this issue and the solutions to those issues and problems for hours on end. But we just talked about the pros and cons of high school. Now it's time to move on to the pros and cons of club and academy. Alright, so I just checked the time for this video, guys, and we're a little bit behind where we should be, and by little I mean a lot. So we're kind of fast forward things and kind of speed things up and just put the pros and the cons of the screen right now for club and academy. I think most of you guys understand and kind of get the gist of the pros and cons of academy and club. So I think we kind of speed through this and talk about the last hurrah of this topic and this subject. We can talk about the pros and cons of high school versus club versus academy all day and not come to any answers or agreements, but the honest truth, guys, is that club, specifically DA, is where the best players play. And whatever league the best players play in, college scouts will be very far behind. So you guys have to adapt with the times. If you think high school is where the talent's at in 2019, you're stuck in 2005, unfortunately. The best, what's the word for it? The best analogy I can give you to really drive this point home for you and to fully understand this concept is like trying to build a social media presence on MySpace. Like it worked back in the day, that's great, but things have changed and things have adapted. So what's adapted the best over the course of the past 10 years is playing DA and playing Academy. So it's adapt or die in the business world, but it's adapt or don't be recruited in the American soccer system. There's no doubt or question, guys, that you can play pro football if you just play high school soccer. Like, it's absolutely possible. But the real question is, the true question is how good that player could have been if he just played club soccer his entire youth career. And I'm sure your response to that statement would be like, Spencer, that's not very fair. You can apply that to anything. It's true. You can apply that sentence, that phrase, to anything. You say the Brazilians down in Brazil, if they didn't grow up playing the street, how good they could have been. You say to me, if I didn't grow up playing at the YMCA, how good I could have been. Like, coulda, woulda, shoulda, things happening to you for a reason. Hindsight's 2020. Like, what's happening to you right now or in the past happening to you for a reason. It's defined and really created who you are today. So don't regret who you are, because that's what's defined you in the past, and things that happened to you in the past have made you who you are today. But we could talk about this for hours on end, critique it, debate it, discuss it. If you guys have any comments below regarding the subject, make sure you guys ask away and fact check me, put down facts, make me look stupid. That's great, all fun and games until someone gets hurt. But that's gonna end this rather long topic to begin today's video. Now it's time to begin the main portion of today's video, and that is training. So let's carry on with the video.
Even if we both break down tonight, and you say you hate me, and we go to bed angry, I know everything will be alright. I'll be here waiting, I promise I'm changing. I just need a little time to show you I'm worth it. I know that I can be a difficult person. I'm a stress case, drive you up the wall when I'm working. Actually, I'm probably worse when I'm not. You don't deserve it, make you nervous, cause you know I'ma break soon. Every time I do, I say something that hurts you. Acting like I'm gone, but we both in the same room. I don't like to be wrong, which I know you relate to. And I know I make you feel like you're at the end of your road. That's when I look at you and tell you I'll be better alone. It's just the pride talking, isn't it? Cause both of us know I'm the definition of wreck if you look into my soul. Comes out the most when I feel I'm in a vulnerable place. Made a lot of mistakes I wish I knew how to erase. When I'm afraid, might get distant and I push you away. But no matter the case, I'ma do whatever it takes. Even if
we both break down tonight, and you say you hate me, and we go to bed angry, I know everything will be alright. I'll be here waiting, I promise I'm changing. I just need time.
Before I bought you the ring, we were fighting back and forth like you were wearing a thing. Two passionate people not afraid to say what they think. Lead a passionate conversation when it's hard to agree. You know me well, sitting on the edge of my seat, looking at life, overanalyzing everything. Always depressed, trying to find a better version of me. Searching for something I know's probably right in front of my feet. Stubborn as me? Maybe not, but you're close to it. Got a lot of issues, I'm trying to work through them. Going to therapy for you, something that's worth doing. When I know you've been there for me through all of my worst moments, and I know it hurts knowing that I carry this weight on my chest, making it difficult for me to open up and connect. A lot of regret, I apologize for all of the stress. That's not what I meant to do. You know I love you to death.
Even if we both break down tonight, and you say you hate me, and we go to bed angry, I know everything will be alright. I'll be here waiting, I promise I'm changing. I just need time.
right, so I made it back to the room, guys. It's about 3:30. I took a little power nap, so I'm half asleep right now. But we got about 2 hours before team photos. So I want to do a little segue transition to talking about boots. So I've been getting a lot of DMs and just messages and emails about just returning boots to Nike and what's like the tearing protocol when it comes to just filing a claim. Like, what do you kind of look at when it comes to returning boots to Nike? How do you figure out if they're going to be accepted based off just the looks? And let me turn the camera around so you guys can really see this in better lights. I've never returned a pair of boots with just this kind of damage. It's always this. So it's always like a stud coming off or it's tearing on the side. It's never based off just like that. Or something, again, just performance-wise, it's going to affect your playing. So it's never just this. It's always something on the side or in the front. You can see a little damage there, but again, that's not too much to return. But this boot is fine compared to this boot. So after 2 months of use, the whole back stud came off of this pair of Vapors, which I never had this problem before with Vapors, but I guess the heat and playing on turf just affected it to the extent where it just melted off, which I've never had, again, this problem before with Vapors, but I guess kind of the combination of turf, heats, and just playing constantly for the past few months with these boots resulted in that happening. But this right here is also returnable, as this separation when it comes to the toe, like, that's pretty deep and pretty wide when it comes to boot tearing and boot separation. That's pretty significant right there. So that can be returned, and obviously the back end can be returned as well. But when it comes to returning boots, you have 2 years when it comes to the manufacturing date. So the manufacturing date is on the right side. So there's two dates always on the inside of boots. It's always the right date. But here's actually the back end, the stud. It's actually glued in, so I thought it was always screwed in, but apparently it's just glue, which actually holds this stud in place. So the entire thing just melted off the boot. So kind of weird, but let's go ahead and move on to a different subject, and that is team photos and team interviews to end today's vlog.
Yeah, sometimes I wanna disappear like I just don't exist. I find a time machine to take me back when I was 6. Maybe younger, either way, I guess the point of it would be to tell that little kid that he's gonna take a lot of hits. Yeah, I'll probably grab your hand and tell you life is hard. If you got questions or you need advice, then talk to God, cause he's the only one that listens, even when you think he isn't. Even good people are great at making bad decisions. Yeah, they ain't gonna take it serious. You find out pretty quick that life is more than just appearances.
3, 2, 1.
My name is Keen McIver. I'm from Trinidad and Tobago. I play attacking midfield. I last played for Gotney IF, and I'm enjoying me for a new experience.
Meu nome é Juan. Eu vim do Brasil. Jogo de volante. Joguei no Artsu, o último clube, e vim para a Alemanha para jogar profissionalmente.
My name is Anthony Lopez. I'm from LA. I'm a forward. I previously played at Rio Claro, Brazil, and I'm here in Germany for a new experience.
Meu nome é Lucas. Sou do Brasil. Jogo de atacante. Meu último clube é o FCA Darmstadt. E eu estou aqui para ir para grande clube profissionalmente.
Hi everyone, my name is Omari Guscott. I'm from Kingston, Jamaica. The last place I played was LIU Brooklyn. My position is forward. Why I'm in Germany is to have a new experience and to take my career to the next level.
Hello everybody, I'm Mitchell Brickman. I'm from Rochester, New York. I'm a defender. The last club that I played at was the Rochester Lancers, and I came to Germany to take my career to the next level and make my first steps towards being a professional footballer.
Meu nome é Lucas Wolfgrella, vim do Brasil. Minha posição é zagueiro. O último clube foi o El Sport Capão Bonito. Eu vim para a Alemanha jogar profissionalmente.
My name is Matt Anderson. I'm from Fort Collins, Colorado. My position is center back. My previous club was Noco FC, and I came to Germany in hopes of playing professional soccer.
Meu nome é Rafael, eu sou do Brasil, jogo de lateral direito. Meu último clube foi AES Los Angeles, e eu estou aqui buscando ser profissional.
My name is Dakota Lobsiger. I'm a left or right back. I'm from Chicago, Illinois. My last club I played for was Orange County FC, and I came to Germany for a new experience in the hopes of playing professional soccer.
2, 1.
Olá, bom dia. Meu nome é Vinícius Henrique. Vim do Rio de Janeiro, Brasil. Jogo de meia esquerda ou meia atacante. Meu último clube foi GRD de Portugal. Meu objetivo aqui na Alemanha é virar jogador profissional.
My name is Weiss Ansari. I come from Springfield, Virginia. I play winger. My previous club was Northern Virginia Football Club. And I'm here in Germany to find success in life and in football.
My name is Julian Stefano. My position is central midfielder and right wing. I'm from Livingston, New Jersey, and I came to Germany to play professional soccer.
اسمي جميل نارا. أنا حارس مرمى من النصر فلسطين. الفريق السابق FC سانتوفن ألمانيا. أنا هنا الاحتراف في أوروبا.
僕の名前は小磯亮です。沖縄県日本出身です。 ポジションはボランチをやってます、元のクラブはズームシュナイダーニューヨークです、ドイツに来た理由は、プロになるためです。よろしくお願いします。
My name is Giancarlo Perez from Queens, New York. I'm a goalkeeper. Last club I played for was Zoom Schneider in New York. And I came to Germany to play soccer.
Hello, my name is Eric Espinoza. Ich komme aus den San Jose, Kalifornien, USA. Meine Position ist Zehner. Meine letzte Mannschaft war Real Union de Irún in Spanien. Und ich bin hier, um Profifußballer zu werden.
See some things about to happen that you can't imagine. At 24, you're dropping an album and you call it mansion. At 25, you put out therapy and gain some traction. Skip the track number 4, now that's a really sad one. Yeah, but